not sure. I got a lot to say today. I'm going to try to fit it all so that it all fits right. You know, we received a word this morning, you know, right off the bat about change, and I certainly agree with change. I've certainly received that part, but you know, sometimes I hear this terminology, and I don't know if this was used this morning, but I hear it in other churches, and I've heard other even Christians use it. They'll use the terminology, and they'll, have you heard this, stuck in a rut? I think somebody, that's it, really improper terminology, should be stuck in the ditch, because a rut is where you want to be. Anybody ever been on a mud road? If you don't stay in the rut, you're in trouble. And if you don't believe me, go out to Colorado and get out of the rut and see what happens to your vehicle. You know, here in Iowa, you end up in the ditch, and it's a hassle. You have to go get your tractor and pull it out or send another vehicle or something. In Colorado, if you get out of the rut and you run off the road, you lose your vehicle and possibly your life. And so the rut is really where you want to be. It's the determination is are you moving? See, in a rut, you can move. In the ditch, you get stuck. I think somebody, like I said, they just wanted to make it because stuck in a rut rhymes. And so that's why they did it that way. But it's really improper terminology because we want to be in a rut. You know, it'd be kind of ridiculous to say to Jesus, well, boy, Jesus, you were really stuck in a rut. All you did was you just kept going around healing all those who are oppressed of the devil. You know what I mean? Couldn't you do something that you were really stuck in a rut? See, the issue is not what you're doing. The issue is what you're doing bringing change? You know what I mean? And so we know that there's a lot of churches that are stuck in the ditch, as was said this morning, because they're doing the same things every week, but what's it bringing? Is it bringing any change? And so what you have to ask yourself is, when you attend this church or any ministry, is your life being changed? If your life is being changed, then we're at least on the right track. But I certainly agree, we always need change, don't we? And I can feel kind of James' frustration. See, I hear a lot of words like that. You know, I hear a lot of words that are kind of generalized, especially when it comes across when words are about like the nation or the world or a particular state or something like that. And I always just set them on a shelf anymore because they're so, well, they're so general and they're so, what's the word I want to use? You know, like the book of Revelation, how it's written. They're so allegorical, or is that the word I'm looking for? They're so, they use terminology that I'm not understanding at all. You know, like we heard one that here a while, Kathy and I heard one, you know, instead of twin towers, it's three towers. And I'm thinking, okay, what do you mean three towers? That doesn't, what are you talking about? Give me something specific. You know, I mean, when Jesus, you know, when the angel came to Mary, what did he say? What did he say? Huh? She was blessed and what? What? Above all women and what else? How did she find out she was going to have a child? Huh? What? The Holy Spirit said what? The angel said what? The Holy One is what? Come upon you and what? And you shall conceive. See? Now that I can understand. A woman could understand that. You know, he didn't say something like, you know, the Holy One will go across the earth and there will be a tower formed in you. And he didn't give, you know, the pillar will come forth from you. And he didn't say all that. When he spoke it, he said it exactly what was going to happen. And I know that a lot of times, though, God does use that kind of language. But I think sometimes, you know, God, you need to be or we need to be in tune with God. What are you really saying? Yeah. And that's just a little side deal. What I really wanted to start my message with, and this is what I was sharing with you Wednesday night, some things I wanted to share was that, you see, I believe there's two systems, and I've shared this before, but it's going to be worth sharing it again. I believe there's two systems. There's the God system and there's the world system. And I think a lot of times we have a tendency to think that in the God system, God or angels or Jesus comes down and does particular things in our life that blesses us. And I'm not going to deny that that doesn't happen sometimes, but my thinking is that when you start to get in the system automatically blesses you. It's not Jesus or angels or you know, God coming down, even like in healing. I think a lot of healing takes place because you tap into a system and health is a part of that system. It's just, you know, the devil operates in God's principles. He just perverts them, right? See, so sickness is something nobody here desires to, I don't think they do. Does anybody here desire to be sick? Do you pray for flu and colds? They just what? They just come up on you, don't they? Because the sickness is a part of this system, the way health is a part of God's system. So sickness. So you know, every time we sin, every time you get angry, every time you get stressful or fearful, sickness doesn't always come on you, does it? It doesn't always. And a lot of times it comes on you when you don't have any of those things. So if it did, then we could say, you know, I never have believed that every time you get stressful or fearful or angry, there's demons waiting around and they go shove germs up your nose and then you get sick. I've never have believed that. It's sickness is a part of the world system. And because we're still so much a part of that system, we're subject to those functions. And so the idea here in church is to get into the God system and we'll start being subject to those functions. Now, you may not like that, you may not believe that, but I've got some pretty strong evidence. You know, Jesus said if you seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, what? He said all those things would be what? Added unto me. Well, how does that happen? Well, we think, well, he comes along and he just starts adding stuff to, you know, he visits Kathy and all of us, and he'll just show up in your room and he starts blessing you. No, that's a part of that system. Those are the wages of that system. You know this is true. I can prove this to you because how many times have you been delivered of things that you never even asked for? You never even had a desire to be delivered. I never had a desire to be delivered from fear of speaking in front of people. Because I had decided when I got out of high school that I could, that as an adult, I could make my own decisions and stay away from situations where I didn't have to speak in front of groups of people. You can do that as an adult. Did you know that? You can make decisions and you can avoid certain areas, certain things in your life that you feel uncomfortable with. So I never asked to be delivered of that. I never, it was not on my mind. It wasn't praying. I wasn't going into intercession. What happened? I started tapping into the system, and that happened because it's a part of that system. Fear is not a part of God's system. And many of you have been delivered of things. I know Kathy has obtained physical things. You know, appliances and things that she wasn't even asking for. She wasn't in deep intercession and prayer, oh God, oh God, oh God, I need this, you know, please bless me. Wasn't confessing, wasn't, they just got added to her because that's a part of the system. And so you and I are trying to obtain to this system. I look at your physical appearances. What's happening to us? Why do we look so much better? It's a part of that system. It's a part of that. I mean, how many of you have spent time in intercession? Oh, I want to look. So, I want to look better. I want to look better. I want to look better. How many of you have gone into deep prayer and desire? I want to look. I want to look. I want to look better. I want to look better. I want to look better. I know it's a desire of ours. Sure, it is. I understand that. But how many of you spent a whole lot of time praying and diligently seeking after looking better? What's happening is we're tapping into that system, and that's a part of that system is life, youth, strength, health, passion. All of those things, we're tapping into that system. And the more we tap into that system, the less the world system will have an effect on us. You see what I mean? And I really believe this, as much sickness as we have, I think we're still healthier than the average person who's not in any way, shape, or form touching God's system. Health is God's system. And so this is what I'm looking for, is that one day we'll obtain to a place. Well, we know we're going to obtain to a place where sickness no longer affects us. But when we're sick, I mean, you know this. Well, this already happened because you've heard it. You've heard about people being healed while they're singing during praise and worship. Well, what happened? They tapped into the system. So I wanted to say that because it has a correlation with where we're going today. And I want you to keep that in mind, is that there's a system that God is trying to get us into. And it's not just a system where God comes down and personally blesses you, or the devil personally attacks you. It's a system. The devil's system is a system of death, attack, persecution, lie, destruction, fear, sickness, you name it. Anything that's bad is his system. Anything that's good is God's system. Okay? And when I say good, I'm not talking about the tree of the good side of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I'm talking about when it's God good. Okay? God good. Every good and perfect. Well, we're going to read that. We're going to read that in a minute. I got ways to go here. First of all, I think I want you to turn to Philippians chapter 3. Of course, a lot of you heard this Wednesday night. Just going to have to listen to it again. Hallelujah. Starting in chapter 3, verse 10. This is Paul speaking. He says, I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and the participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in death. New King James says, being conformed to his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection of the dead. I like the King James that says, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Now, we read that scripture, right? There's a whole mouthful in that right there. I mean, there's quite a bit of teaching that we can do in that. But one of the things I do want to bring out is that we know that Paul cannot be talking about going to heaven there. Because if he's talking about going to heaven there, that means since he's not already attained, that means that if he died right now, he'd go to hell. Because he says he hasn't attained yet. I think we'll read that here. He says that I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. So we know he's not talking about heaven there. He's talking about obtaining something here on the earth. Because if it was just about accepting Jesus and going to heaven, could we say that this ought to be easy for anybody to answer. If Paul died right when he's writing this, right after he gets done writing this, where do you think he's going to end up in eternity? Yeah. It's not a trick question, folks. I mean, I'm just saying we're using heaven in an understanding that other churches can understand, because most of what's preached today is about going to heaven. So if Paul dies right here, do you think he's going to heaven? Or do you think he's going to hell? Heaven. You think he's going to heaven or hell? Heaven. All right. So when he says, not that I have already attained, it's obvious he's talking about something that he can obtain here on the earth, not something that is after he dies. Do you have something?
Mine says, verse 11, if possible, I may attain to the resurrection that lifts me out from among the dead, even while in the body.
Right. That's great. That's a great, you know, interpretation right there, or great writing right there. And again, resurrection, again, means recovery. So Paul is saying, I have not yet obtained to the recovery. Well, the recovery of what? Well, if we read in the book of Acts, we find that the heavens must contain Jesus until what? The recovery or the restoration of all things. And that's why Paul says he hasn't attained yet. So obviously, you know what? Paul is still getting sick. Paul is still getting older. And we know that because he says his outward man was perishing. We read that several weeks ago. But he's pressing on. What's he saying? I press on that I may hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me, has laid hold of me. And he's not talking about ministry or helping people. He's talking about obtaining a resurrection or recovery. That's our job. Our job is to obtain the resurrection and the recovery. When we obtain the resurrection and the recovery, ministry will flow out of that. Helping people will flow out of that. But you got to, we have to keep things in the proper order. You can't get out of order with the things of God. And too many times we as people are being told to go out and help people before we focus on the recovery. Focus on the recovery. That's what Paul was focused on. He's not saying that I may obtain, you know, to be a big apostle, or that I may obtain to have more churches, or that I may obtain to help more people. He's saying that I'm going to obtain, I want the recovery. He says, that's what I'm laying hold of Christ for, and I want Christ to lay hold of me. And he says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. And you see, I'm one of those preachers. I try to preach both. I think if people will be honest, you know, as you've listened to me, you know that I have preached good things. I have preached victory over sin. I've preached victory, no death. I mean, I've preached the messages where God is most to strengthen us. I remember one where you guys got really excited, and I talked about we're coming apart at the seams while our seams are coming apart. And y'all got, boy, you were all, I thought I was on this verge of applause. But I also like to focus on the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death. Why? So that we may attain to the recovery, which is what? His life. We don't want to just talk about being conformed to his death, 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 death. There's a reason for it, and that's to obtain the recovery, which is his life. But we have to go through his death to obtain his life, and that's where I find that most ministers are skipping that part. We're just wanting to preach the power of his resurrection, but not the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death. And so we surround ourselves with ministers that are constantly preaching the power of his resurrection. Okay? What is the power of his resurrection? The healing, the prosperity, all the good things, the ministry, you know, being an apostle, being a prophet, prophetic words, all the positive things that God has for us, that's what we like to hear. But then when it comes to the fellowship of his sufferings, everybody seems to go cuckoo. I remember Randy Shankle was a man who ministered both sides. And I don't know what you think about him. It doesn't make any difference. I know that he saved Kathy's and my life with the things that he was preaching back in the 80s. And I was, you know, we listened to him, and boy, it was just wonderful. I mean, half the time we didn't know what he was talking about. There was something, though, resonating inside of us, and we'd listen to it over and over again until we got it. And I remember they took him off the air, and they put a soap opera on in his place. A Christian, that's all it had. The stories were the same. The stuff was the same. It just had a label, Christian. And that way it gave carnal church people something to watch that was, quote, Christian, but yet a soap opera. And Kathy called him. She called TBN. I mean, she was hot. I don't remember how the conversation went down. She could probably tell you better than I do, but she was just basically saying, why did you take him off and put on a soap opera? And they said, well, he doesn't have anything new. I think, isn't that what it was? They didn't have, you don't remember? Oh, I remember. Well, see, I remember because those things are pivotal things in our life, because that was a guy that I finally began to listen to that was preaching the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death. And this is what it was. It was a whole nother side that I'd never, that's how I saw it at that time. I'd been hearing the power of his resurrection, and that was wonderful. And all of a sudden I hear this guy, and it's like, that's when I began to realize the more I know, the less I know. Because here was a whole nother side I'd never heard before, and yet it was attractive to me. It hurt, it stung, but it hurt so good. You know, it was like when we were listening to the power of his resurrection, that always makes you feel good and want to jump up and down and yeah, and shout and hallelujah. This here made you feel, oh, I feel better. That's what it did. And so he was one of the few ministers that I ever heard that preached both sides of it. Most of them only preach the power of his resurrection. And we're trying to get people, we think if we preach the power of his resurrection, that's going to cause people to change into what God wants. It doesn't change. You need both aspects of it. God shows no partiality. God's not going to give you one without the other. And likewise, we can't have just people that are preaching his death and his sufferings all the time. Because that'll lead you down the wrong road as well. You'll end up in the ditch. I want to be in the rut. You know, I don't care what. I know that it's just going to be hard for people to get to, because you've heard that so long, stuck in a rut. You don't get stuck in the rut. You get stuck when you get out of the rut and you get in the ditch. Trust me, I've been there many times. When you're in the rut, it feels good. The minute you pop out, who's driven on a mud road? Boy, all of you guys have driven on a mud road. Have you ever been in the rut? What happens when you pop out of the rut? Have you ever popped out of the rut? Yeah, what happens? You go all over everywhere, don't you? Sounds kind of like the church, doesn't it? You go all over everywhere, and you end up in the ditch. And what are you trying to do when you slide out of that rut? You try to get right back in it, don't you? Because you know what's going to happen if you don't. And has anybody ever gotten out of the rut and then slid in the ditch? Then what happened? There you go. See? So next time you hear, if you don't get anything else out of this, at least learn that stuck in a rut is wrong. It's stuck in a ditch. Okay, now turn with me to, let's see, where do I want to go here? I think we'll go to Luke because I like to finish the stories. You know, I know a lot of times I do it, and a lot of other preachers do it, is we'll teach and we'll pull a scripture out, and we'll read about half of it, and then leave the other half. And I don't know if you recall when we had the youth meeting that time, and the girl was preaching up here, and she was reading, and I can't remember, I wish I could, but she read down and she stopped. She read the power of his resurrection, and as soon as she got to the part of the fellowship and his suffering, and being conformed to his death, she quit. So I marked it there and went ahead and she finished. And then I said, would you please continue to read? And she read it. She finished that. She goes, oh, yeah, well, yeah, you got to do this too. And I thought, you know, that's just as important. Listen, I love the power of his resurrection, folks. But if you don't have his fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death, we're not going to resurrect.
Right.
We're going to jump up and down and be hallelujahing and having great services, but nothing's really going to change. Nothing's going to change. Okay, where are we at in Luke here? Okay, you know what I want to do is, I think I want to start in chapter 4, verse 1. And I know a lot of this, it seems like I'm jumping around, but it all fits together if you think about it. It says, then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being tempted for 40 days by the devil. And in those days he ate nothing, and afterward, when they had ended, he was hungry. And the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to be bread. Now, we're going to stop right there for just a minute. Notice the devil said that the devil tempted him. What is wrong with changing stones into bread? Bread is good, especially if you're hungry. How many here think eating is a sin? See, he's not tempting him with an R-rated movie. He's not tempting him with a dirty joke. He's not tempting him to steal, to lie, to kill, to murder. With pornography. He didn't have a Playboy and say, if you're the Son of God, look at this. Why is that so funny? He didn't tempt him that way. He tempted him with something that it's like what we read in the days of Noah. Remember, they were eating, drinking, marrying, being given in marriage. None of that stuff was wrong. What's the devil tempting Jesus with? He's tempting him to do something that God has not told him to do. And so many times we get words, I don't really want to go there because I could, but I don't want to. People get words, there's healing in your hands. Well, here's a flash for you. There's healing in everybody's hands. According to the scripture, okay? And I don't want to go down that road about what's a word and what isn't or anything, or what's really being spoken by God, or what we're just saying what God has already said and then prophesying it over you. But there's healing in everybody's hands. And that's how the enemy always gets us, is if there's healing in your hands, why don't you go and heal so-and-so? And you'll hear that every time you see, because what God has given you, his love and his compassion for people, every time you see a sick person, you're going to hear, if you had healing in your hands, you'd go heal that person. Any of you watch St. Jude's commercials, hospital commercials? See those little kids? That's heartbreaking, isn't it? And every time I hear that little voice, if you really believed in healing. And unfortunately, most people yield to it. Here's a question. If Jesus had tried, now you have to think on this. If Jesus had commanded the stones to become bread, would they have become bread? I don't think. Now think before you answer. Huh? No, they wouldn't have. No, they wouldn't have. They would never have become bread. And now the devil has an accusation that is true. This is not a false accusation. He's now got a true accusation. You just operated in lawlessness. You are now lawlessness, Jesus. You're now disqualified. You're not sinless now. Let's go on. Then the devil taking up on a high. Oh no, I'm sorry. I know I didn't read four, but I guess I need another temptation here. I'll go ahead and read this one. But Jesus answered him, saying, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God." Okay, now I just want to stop there because there's probably more places where it shows the temptation, and everybody who knows their Bible is going to know this. What was really the next temptation? This one here is to show him the kingdoms of the world, but what was the next temptation that came to him? Yeah, said, took him to the pinnacle of the temple and said, jump off, basically. And what did he say? He said, for the angels have charge over you, and in their hands they will hold you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. So now he's even using the word of God. Question, if Jesus would have cast himself off, would he have lived? Would the angels have rushed down there and... Aren't we glad that he didn't... Yeah, I know. Listen, the Bible is full of people saying if. to Jesus. Even on the, when he was on the cross, I talked, you know, Wednesday night about the Pharisees saying, if you're the Son of God, come down, then we'll believe you. Even the thief said, if you are who you say you are, save yourself and us with you. And so one of the things we always have to listen to is, if you're who you say you are, then do this. And we've got to ask ourselves this, or even when we look out into other people's lives, how many people have yielded to the if? The if is to get you to do something that God has never told you to do. And ministers use that all the time on people to try to get you to do stuff that God has not told you to do. And they'll make it sound good. Hey, turning stones into bread when you're 40 days hungry, that'd be a good thing, wouldn't it? That would be a good thing. But that's not what God commanded him to do. And I really like the response, because he said, you shall not live by bread alone, what is man made, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth, not that's written down, out of the mouth of God. Which means, what comes out of the mouth? The spoken word. That's what we live under. And so many times you hear, if you would do this, if God's really called you, if. Now, a lot of times the Bible does say if. You know, Paul says something about, he talks about the blessings of God, and he says, if you continue, even Jesus said it, if you continue in my word. But that's not trying to get you to do something that God hasn't told you to do. You see what, you have to separate the difference, you see what I mean? And every time you hear that word if, or somebody challenges you, I've been challenged many times, well, if you believe in healing, why don't you heal yourself? If you believe in what's going on around us about, victory over death, well, if you believe in what happens, what's going to happen if one of us dies? We'll see, it doesn't work. See, the devil cannot accuse you of lawlessness when he's telling you if. It's only when you yield to the if, now he's got lawlessness on you. Now you've just entered the world system and all its fruits. Because the devil was doing that to Jesus all the time. If you're the Son of God. If you're this. We'll read it here in a minute in Luke. Here in just a second. Then the devil, taking him up on a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said to him, all this authority I will give you and their glory, for this has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I wish. That's not a lie. It's exactly how that's him. He can give it to whoever he wishes, and that authority has been given to him. Therefore, if you will worship before me, all will be yours. Tell me, if Jesus follows God, is it all going to be his anyway? He's just got to wait for it longer, doesn't he? And again, that's where he gets us. Boy, there's a lot in here. If we read, we see our lives in these scriptures really bad. He just has to wait a longer time for it. And so when we listened Wednesday night, the testing of the word is not when it doesn't work. The testing of the word is when God has spoken to you, and the devil tests you by trying to get you to operate in it before you're supposed to operate in it. That's where the test is. Once you've operated and it's failed, now he's got you. And I'm firmly believe that until the church understands this, we're just going to have great services. Listen, I'm not saying that miraculous things aren't happening, because once in a while somebody makes a mistake, has an accident, and actually taps into the kingdom of God. Well, they do, because it's a system that's here, and if you tap into it, you receive of that system. But most of the time, we're not tapping into it because we're not growing up. Okay, here we go. And Jesus answered and said to him, "Get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." Oh, here it is. I'm sorry. I got them mixed up. Then he brought him to Jerusalem, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you and to keep you. And in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered and said to him, "It has also been said, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Now when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went out throughout all the surrounding region, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." What's he preaching there? He's preaching the power of his resurrection right there. Now look at how the people responded. He closed the book and he gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all around the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" In other words, if you read Mark's version of it, it said they really liked it. Because why? Because he's preaching the power of his resurrection. Now he's going to preach the fellowship of his sufferings. Now he's going to preach being conformed to his death. And he said to them, "You will surely say this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself.'" See, there it is.
Yeah.
There it is. If you really are who you say you are, heal yourself. Heal yourself. "Whatever we have heard done in Capernaum, do you also hear in your country?" Then he said to them, "Assuredly, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a great famine throughout all the land. But to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, a woman who was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." So all those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. That's why the church has a hard time receiving healing and blessing and prosperity, is because as soon as we preach the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death, as soon as God tries to bring correction to us, immediately we get filled with rage. And what did they do to Jesus? They took him outside the city and they were going to throw him off a cliff. We went from gracious words to throwing him off the cliff. They said what? Said they spoke well. Well, let me read Mark's version, because that'll make it a little more powerful. I'll have to flip back to Mark. This is Mark chapter 6. Jesus left there and went to his hometown accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many heard him who were amazed. "Where did this man get these things?" they asked. What's this wisdom that has been given him? What are these remarkable miracles he's performing? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son? And the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters with us here?" And they took offense at him. But they didn't take offense at him until he told them about Elijah and Elisha. And one of the things we have to remember is that when so many people get stuck in the hometown thing, that Jesus wasn't accepted in the hometown, but we read it was in his country. And what really is our country? What is Jesus really saying here? He brings up Elijah and Elisha. You notice, neither one of those guys was respected anywhere. Jesus wasn't given honor anywhere. He's not just talking about his hometown, folks. The scripture says that Jesus was despised and rejected, not just by his hometown. What does it say he was despised and rejected by? By men. All the prophets were rejected. Isaiah was rejected. Jeremiah had no honor. Ezekiel had no honor. Moses really didn't have any honor. None of the prophets really had honor. Jesus did not have honor. A few people did. I'm not saying that a few people didn't. But don't get stuck in just the hometown thing. Like, well, you can be honored then anywhere else you go. Not if you're a real prophet. Only if you preach the power of his resurrection. Then they'll honor you. If you preach the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death, you're not going to have a large following. And Jesus didn't either. I got to get back. Did I finish Luke? Where am I at, Luke, here? You know, so many times we think this is a huge, huge mistake that we make, is we remember how it used to be when we first came into this. How excited we were. Do you know why? Because you came in under the power of his resurrection. And you thought it was all about you. Naturally, you're always going to be open when it's all about you. If you don't think so, go to any child and make it all about them and watch how open they become. Go to any adult and make it all about them and see how open they become. And we always try to go back to how we felt. I never want to do that. I like the way I feel right now. Because I like the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death. It was exciting when I first came into it. I've given the testimony, the prayer list I had, all the stuff I was going to get. And I thought this was all about healing. Because you have a tendency to think your life is okay. And the reason you think that is because you were never taught that your life can change. So you think, this is it. I'm as good as I'm going to get. So now God has blessed me with all of this healing and blessing and prosperity and all of these different things. Wow, what could there not be to like? And then you hear the marismos. And then you find out what there is not to like. Remember how people reacted to that? How did they react to that book?
A lot of anger.
Grumbling, anger, complaining. It sounds kind of like, and they were filled with rage. You and I have a responsibility to preach both sides. People love to be sung over. They love to be prayed over. They love to be told the power is resurrection. But you also need to tell them the fellowship of his sufferings and me conformed to his death. You know what I mean? And it's always God's pattern. Listen to this. It's always God's pattern. This is what I see in Scripture. Is to present himself to people who don't know anything. He presents himself with the power of his resurrection first. That's what he does. He doesn't present him first with the fellowship of his sufferings or being conformed to his death. He presents him with the power of his resurrection. So when it's somebody that doesn't know anything, we've got, you know, denominational people that know anything, worldly people, you know, people on drugs and everything, what God is going to do is he's going to come down and he's going to demonstrate himself with good. Going to demonstrate, that's the pattern. Throughout the whole deal, it's the pattern. He demonstrates himself with the power of his resurrection. But as soon as he demonstrates himself with the power of his resurrection, he's going to start bringing you into the fellowship of his suffering and the conforming to his death. Got to have that. If you don't have that, you're done. You're going to spend your whole life in the trying to get the power of his resurrection, jumping up and down, liking what you're hearing, and what's going to happen is you're going to get old and you're going to lose hope. And that's why there's so few older people in the body of Christ. It's an appealing message. The power of his resurrection is an appealing message to the young and the middle-aged. Do you know why? Because they're not hurting. For the most part, the majority of them are not hurting. How many of you have pains in your body now that you didn't have when you were 20 years old? Gee. And so what happens is that we keep being preached the power of his resurrection. We keep getting generalized words about how God's going to do all of this stuff, and yet we're never told how to do it. I'm telling you how to do it. You just have to look at this scripture here and say, I need to be conformed to your death that I may obtain. Not that I've already obtained, God. Not that you've already obtained, James. Not that you've already obtained, Brenda. Paul, Joseph, Jana, everybody here. Not that we've already attained. But what are we going to do? What did Paul do? He pressed on. So whenever I hear those a word or something like that, I just say, hey, I just haven't attained, but I'm going to. As long as I continue to do what God says to do, and even if I don't, I'm going to die believing I'm going to obtain it. Because Paul did. You think Paul gave up somewhere? We've got to have both. They rose up and thrust him out of the city, and they led him to the brow of the hill on which their city was built, that they might throw him down over the cliff. Boy, that'd make you want to get invited back to that church, wouldn't you? Can you imagine the temptation that was going through his mind after this little scenario? Not only, I never even thought of that one. Not just that one, but he said to call down fire. And I never thought of that, but I was thinking more of, I must have said something wrong. If I was who I say I was, I wouldn't have made those people that angry. I wonder where that thought would come from. There's another if, huh? Watch out for the ifs. If you don't buy that car today, it'll get sold tomorrow by somebody else. Anybody ever heard that? You hear if all the time, don't we? That's how the devil gets us, is if. And once you yield to the if, now he's got you. I mean, God has said things like he's going to prosper you. Well, if God was going to prosper you, you'd go out and you'd do this, and you'd go out and you'd go, you'd just go to work for anybody. You'd just go out and do this and this and this. No, what is God saying to you? Would it be wrong to go out and get a job and go do this and this and this if God told you you were going to be prosperous? That's not a wrong thing, is it? But is that what God's telling you to do? I'm not saying you're not supposed to work. I'm just saying that a lot of people, when the finances start to get a little thin, they start to get a little cuckoo. And so they start hearing a lot of ifs. Well, if you just do this, well, if we would just do that, honey, if we would just do this and this and this, we'd be all right. Go home. You want to put something on your refrigerator? Just write a big, bold if. That's how the enemy gets you, and you see it all through Scripture. And I don't mean just his Gospels. Look all through the Old Testament. How many people had to face if? And it got him in trouble. They might throw him down over the cliff. Then passing through the midst of them, he went on his way. I like that. Because he didn't yield to any of the ifs, and because he preached a message that didn't show partiality, they couldn't kill him. Oh, thank you, Lord. Now let's, we talked about Naaman, so I want to go back and read Naaman. I thought it was interesting, too. You know, Brenda was reading last Sunday out of Deuteronomy, you know, the blessings and the cursings. And like I said, I shared Wednesday night. That's what I was reading before the, or maybe it was Sunday morning. I was reading that Sunday morning before service because it was going to be, you saved me from having to read all that. I thought it's interesting that one of the things that we have to keep in mind is that when she was reading that, there's a particular scripture in there, and it says, when you and your king that you choose to be over you, they hadn't chosen the king yet. How did God know they were going to choose a king? I thought, you know, that should have been that should have been an alert, a tip-off that we were going to do. They should, you know, when they read that, when Moses read that to them, they should have immediately fell on their faces and said, we don't want a king. We want no king but you. But see, they missed it. And it was right in there. When the king, they haven't chosen a king yet. It's a long time in the future before they choose a king, and yet God already knows that's what they're going to do. Huh? Yeah, oh sure, because he tries to work through anything he can work through. Of course he blesses them. But every time we choose an if, you know, we can look at it, and that was an if. If you were a nation, you'd have a king like all the other nations. Okay, we want a king. Because we want to be like all the other nations. And God will work through that, but boy, every time you yield to an if, you're in the wrong system. And see, that system blesses you or unblesses you, however you want to look at it, with its fruit. And we're all in it. No condemnation. And like I said, God always blesses him. He always manifests himself to the unbeliever, to the unknowing, in the power of his resurrection. Because he knows we've been hoodwinked. You think God knows we've been deceived? And do you think God knows we've been religionized? And to think that he's the taker, that he's the murderer, that he's the killer, that he's the destroyer? So what's he do? He comes in and he does something that's diametrically opposed to our belief in what God is. And he comes down and he miraculously heals us or blesses us with something, whether it be a healing or some type of miracle or some type of finance, or even just speaking into your heart to where he reveals himself to you, and all of a sudden it like takes your breath away. He just revealed himself who he really is. But once you've been revealed to that, that's supposed to clue you in to say, I want to know this guy. There's a whole lot of stuff I've been told about him that's not right, and I want to know who this guy is. So I want to find out who you are. And God says, okay. You got the power of his resurrection. Now I'm going to give you the fellowship of his suffering. You said you wanted to know me. You said you wanted to understand me. You sang, bring the fire. You sang, you're all I want. You're all I ever needed. Okay. Running after you. Strip away. We go on and on, can't we, of the songs that we sing here. And they're good songs. I'm not making fun of them. But when we sing them, God is saying, okay, I'm still going to bring you. Listen, he doesn't just show the power of his resurrection once. And then it's all suffering and death. It's all together. Every time you conform to his death, you pick up a recovery of his life. That's how it works. It's not, we're death, recovery. Death, recovery. It's death, recovery, death, recovery, death, recovery, death, recovery. That's how it works. He just starts out with the power of his resurrection first. And so, see, something we have to keep in mind is that when Jesus is coming to them and talking to about Elijah and Elisha, we just read in Luke and Mark. Remember, they don't have the New Testament, okay? Moses to them was like Jesus is to us. When they look back into the Old Testament, yeah, they had Isaiah, Jeremiah, all the prophets would be like Paul, Peter, James, and John is to us. To them, Moses, though, was the guy. Just like Jesus is to us, right? We love Paul. We preach from his epistles. We preach from John's epistles, from Peter's epistles. But where does all those epistles focus back to? Jesus, right? All right? When he's coming to them, that's their system is. They've got Isaiah, Jeremiah, you know, Ezekiel, all the minor prophets. But it all focuses back to Moses, doesn't it? So when Jesus is preaching this to them, when Jesus is reading this to them, remember, their focus is what Moses said. And Moses wrote Deuteronomy. They knew that much better than we do. Because that's what they were preached out of. Because remember, the Pharisees were always referring back to Moses. Notice they never said, well, Jeremiah said, or Ezekiel said, or Isaiah said. They always said, Moses said. That's who they always went back to. So the first five books of the Bible is what they were really focused on. They liked the others, just like we do, but that's what they were really focused on. So when Jesus comes and he makes that statement to them, and he says there were in the days of, you know, there were many widows in the days of Elijah, and there were many lepers in the days of Naaman. Why did they get so angry? It's because he just revealed to them through the book of Deuteronomy that they were being disobedient to God. Why? Because nothing was happening. If you go back and read the blessings and the cursings, what were the blessings supposed to be? Head, not the tail. Blessed going in, coming out. Baskets will be full. The fruit of your womb will be what? You're going to have rain in due season. Your crops are going to be good. Now, he's speaking to a bunch of people now that are under Roman rule. They're being taxed. They're having famines. They're the tail. And Jesus is saying, hey, you know, I sent Elijah was a prophet, and nobody respected him. Elisha was a prophet. Nobody respected him. Now, here I am, and you're not going to respect me. And it made him angry. Because, you see, in the time of the famine, if you've got a prophet like Elijah, do you think the famine might have been fixed? Had the whole nation gone to Elijah and honored him for who he was, do you think that famine could have been fixed? Yep. Do you think under Elisha, all the lepers that were there, had they honored Elisha, do you think they could have been fixed? Yep. Or do you think God is the respecter of prayer? You think God shows partiality? You think God just wanted to heal a foreigner and not heal his own people? No. And he just wanted to teach them a lesson? No. Absolutely not. And so when Jesus comes and he reads this, they're putting two and two together and figuring out what he's saying, is that we're in this mess because we don't respect our prophets and you're not going to respect me. And that made him angry. Okay, in 2 Kings, we'll read about Naaman. Sure, yeah. See, that's just it. Jesus is healing the outsiders. He's healing everybody. Anybody who knows who he is, who's hearing God, who he is, can get healed. The foreigner doesn't make any difference. And even under the Old Testament, the foreigner could have gotten in on the covenant, the covenants of the kingdom of God. These people know what's going on. They're under tremendous what? Oppression. I want to say pressure. Oppression. So when he makes that statement, they're thinking about the situation, the life that they're having, and they get angry at Jesus. And this is something I think that he said too. Throughout Scripture, or he made it in one statement, but I see through this through all Scripture is that there was always possibilities for tremendous windows of heaven for God to break in to the world, and this was one of them right here. What would have happened if they would have bowed the knee and said, "Help us"? What must we do? What must me do? What must we do to be saved? What would have happened there? And you find this all throughout Scripture. You know, Noah's Ark, it doesn't make any difference where it is, but there was always the dedication of the temple. you know, when they came to Jeremiah and they said, what must we do? And they said, we'll do whatever you say to do. And Jeremiah told them, and then they didn't do it. All throughout Scripture, you find places where tremendous revival could have taken place. You know, when David comes back and says, and the women are singing, Saul has killed his thousands and David his 10,000. What should Saul have done? He said, he should have said, I'm glad David's on my side. I'm glad David's on my side. But no, what does he do? Well, if you were really the king of Israel, you'd get rid of this guy because he's a threat. It's always going to be an if. I mean, there's just place after place after place, and you read it and go through the book of Judges. There's just place after place where tremendous revival should have broken out and never did. Because as soon as God tries to bring us to the fellowship of his suffering and the conforming to his death, we get angry and we get enraged. And we buck it. There's no love. We are being critical. We are just pointing out our sins. We're supposed to point out your sins. It's what's the motivation for pointing them out. It's not that we're not supposed to. I heard this. You know, you better be careful. You don't just go around pointing out people's sins. No, we're supposed to point them out, but we're supposed to point them out in the correct way. That's supposed to lead them to repentance. Our motivation is to want to see those people change into the image of who Jesus is. That's why we point them out. That's why they're pointed out to me. Where are we at? 2 Kings? I got to read name and story because I got to finish the name and story. Because we need to finish it. I think it's 2 Kings, somewhere in chapter 3, 5. Not 35, chapter 5. Do you want me to read the whole story? Okay. Verse 1. Now Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great and honorable man in the eyes of his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. He was also a mighty man of valor, but a leper. And the Syrians had gone out on raids and had brought back captive a young girl from the land of Israel. She waited on Naaman's wife. Then she said to her mistress, if only my master were with the prophet who is in Samaria, for he would heal him of his leprosy. You know, that's pretty good for her to do that. Being a captive. I mean, being stolen. And you're trying to help the guy that stole you? You know, must have been a pretty good guy, even though he stole her. Says he was an honorable man. So he must not have beat her and whipped her and kicked her and treated her badly. But I thought that was kind of nifty. For he would heal him of his leprosy. And Naaman went and told his master, saying, thus and thus said the girl who is from the land of Israel. Then the king of Syria said, go now, and I will send a letter to the king of Israel. You know, it's neat that he even went, that he even believed her. Well, yeah, why would you believe somebody that you've taken captive? Wouldn't you think that they would be tricking you to do something funky or something? But he believed her and saw her character. Then the king of Israel said, go now, and I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So he departed and took with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 changes of clothing. Then he brought the letter to the king of Israel, which said, you know what? As I'm reading this and I read the 10 talents of silver and the shekels of gold, somebody needs to send somebody like that to us, to me. Woo! How much? I received that, yeah. And how much?
150 pounds of gold.
Ooh, yeah, baby.
10 sets of clothing. He's
I'll buy 10 sets of clothing with the silver and the gold. Now, be advised when this letter, I'm just kidding, sort of. Now, be advised when this letter comes to you that I have sent Naaman my servant to you that you may heal him of his leprosy. As soon as the king of when the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to kill and make alive, that this man sends a man to me to heal him of his leprosy? Therefore, please consider and see how he seeks a quarrel with me." So it was when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Please let him come to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel." Then Naaman went with his horses and chariot, and he stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored to you, and you shall be clean." But Naaman became furious, went his way, and said, "Indeed, I said to myself, he will surely come out to me, stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and wave his hand over the place and heal the leprosy. Are not the Abana and the Pharpar rivers of Damascus better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" So he turned and went away in a rage. And his servants came near and spoke to him and said, "My father, if the prophet had told you to do something great, would you not have done it? How much more then, he says to you, wash and be clean." So he went down and he dipped 7 times in the Jordan according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. And he returned, now we're getting into some good important stuff here. And he returned to the man of God, and he and all his aides, and came and stood before him. And he said, "Indeed, now I know there is no God in all the earth except in Israel. Now therefore, please take a gift from your servant." Now what's he saying? He's saying there's no God in all the earth, right? Except in Israel. "Now therefore, please take this gift for your servant." But he said, "As the Lord lives before whom I stand, I will receive nothing." And he urged him to take it, but he refused. So Naaman said, "If not, please let your servant be given 2 mule loads of earth. For your servant will no longer offer either burnt offering or sacrifice to other gods, but to the Lord." Okay, here we go. Typical us. "Yet in this thing may the Lord pardon your servant. When my master goes into the temple of Ramon to worship there, and he leans on my hand, and I bow down in the temple of Ramon, when I bow down in the temple of Ramon, may the Lord please pardon your servant in this thing." And I like what, "And then he said to him, go in peace. So he departed from him a short distance." Now see, Elijah, this was Elisha, remember? Elijah would have never said, "Go in peace," after making that statement. I've said this before so many times. Elijah preached both aspects of the kingdom of God. Elijah preached and demonstrated the resurrection power, but he also preached what? Conforming to his death and the fellowship of his sufferings. Elisha only preached the resurrection, the power of his resurrection. That's why Elisha, I mean, none of them really felt like they were prophets. See, like just like the king of Israel said, "Well, who am I? Am I God?" The letter was supposed to send him to Elisha. But see, the king didn't even recognize that Elisha was a prophet. But if you read Elisha's story, you'll find that never, ever did he try to turn the hearts of the people back to God, ever. He did powers of resurrection, but he never tried to turn their hearts. And so if you read in my Greek study book, it said he got to live, he was wealthier than Elijah. He got to live in the palace with the king. Where did Elijah live? He lived out in the sticks, didn't he? And when we get to the New Testament, who is it that we're compared to? Elijah. Yeah, who is John? Who is he compared to? And what was John preaching? He was preaching both aspects, though, because we've learned in here, remember that he was, remember when the disciples came to him and they said everything that this man said about Jesus was true, when he was talking about his miracles? So John was preaching that Jesus was going to come and do miracles. So he was preaching the power of his resurrection. But what was John preaching when he was out there baptizing? He was preaching repentance, which is what? Which is conforming to his death, isn't it? To change. Tell me, how much honor did John get? See? People don't get on. When you preach the fellowship of his suffering and being conformed to his death, that's when the people get upset. And that's what makes it so hard for the church to receive healing, is because God does not show partiality. We have to take it all. If we don't take it all, you get none. Because that's the system. In order to get into the system, we have to do it the correct way. Otherwise, you don't get in the system. Sitting listening to the power of his resurrection every Sunday morning is not going to get you the power of his resurrection. We know many people that have died that way. And you try to minister. How many here have ever tried to minister to people conforming to his death and the fellowship of his suffering, and they get owie with you? Pattern throughout the scriptures. I think one guy in here, I think he got sawn in half. I see that. That's kind of ticking people off, isn't it? I know Jeremiah, I think he got let down in a bunch of mud, didn't he?
Red and water.
Red and water and a bunch of mud. And what was, and all Jeremiah was trying to do was to save the nation. Trying to save the people. That's what Jesus was trying to do. When he walked in and he preached this sermon, he demonstrated, he preached first, power in his, heal the blind, set at liberty the captives, rah, rah, shish, boom, bah, we like that. Then he starts to teach them how to do it, and they miss it. They get angry. They did exactly what they did under Elijah and Elijah. They were filled with rage. That's why it's so difficult for us to receive healing. To whom much is given, much will be required. And the unbeliever out there hasn't been given anything, so nothing's really required of them yet. But when God demonstrates himself, now you start. You can't miss that in the teachings here of Jesus. He would heal them, then he'd teach them the kingdom of God. He'd demonstrate the power of his resurrection, then he'd demonstrate the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death. Bink, 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 just one right after the other. The woman, what was it, from Samaria that went to the well? Remember the woman that went to the well? What did he do? She said, you know, they strike up a conversation, and what does Jesus do? He tells her all things that she ever did. That's the power of his resurrection. That really excited her, didn't it? And it really excites people. And that's the can I say it this way without you thinking it bad? That's the hook. The draw. It's not a hook, a bad hook. It's the draw. Because he demonstrates who he is. But as soon as he demonstrates who he is, he begins to minister to you with the fellowship of his sufferings, which is what? Might as well bring that up, because somebody's going to think, yeah, I'm sick for the Lord. That's the No, he was never sick. What are we talking about when we talk about the fellowship of his sufferings? What is Paul trying to, that he wants to know the fellowship of his sufferings? You think Paul wants to get sick?
No.
You think Paul wants to have a terminal disease? You think Paul wants to be so poor that he can't do it? You think that's the fellowship of his sufferings? No. What was the fellowship of his sufferings? That's right. Being obedient to God to the point where nobody's going to like you. You're going to suffer. I don't think it was fun to get let out to a cliff to be thrown out. Yay! Look at how they responded to my sermon. 5 minutes? I guess it is 5 minutes, yeah. Okay. Anyway, we need to finish the story. And Naaman, that's what he says. I know your God is. How many of us and how many people do you know? I know your God is God, but I still want to bow down to Ramon. And it could be anybody. That's just the story there. I still want to bow down. But I know your God is God, but I still want to bow down. And as a result, see, here's an opportunity. There was an opportunity for revival to break out in Syria. Right there. Right there. But no, we want to bow down to Ramon. We don't want to make waves because I love the power of his resurrection, but if I don't bow down in Ramon, now I'm going to experience the fellowship of his sufferings and I'm going to have to be conformed to his death, and I want that. So please forgive me when I don't do that. We got people in church today, in denominational churches, that's really the way they live. They're actually asking God to forgive them before they go out and do stuff, knowing they're going to do it. And that's actually a concept that they have. Well, I know I can do wrong things because God will forgive me. You ever heard of that? There you go. There's your story right there. And as a result, we never hear of Naaman again. Country didn't know. It didn't turn because he still bowed down to Ramon. He loved the power of the resurrection, didn't he? Loved being healed of leprosy. That's a great thing too, isn't it? I love it too. But he failed the test when it came to conforming to the sufferings and conforming to his death. Or experiencing the fellowship of Christ's sufferings. He failed it. And as a result, we never hear of Naaman again. Yeah.
And, you know, it says in verse 1 that the king had great admiration for Naaman. And so Naaman had the king's ear. Mm-hmm. And because Naaman said, well, you know, forgive me. I know God's the most high God, but I still want to bow down. When the king goes in and bows down to his idol, and he leans on my arm, I still want to bow and forgive me, God. Like you said, if he had stood up and went back and said, I've been healed by the most high God, and, O king, you know, I love you and I will serve you forever, but since God has showed himself to me, I can't bow down to this idol. And like you said, the king would have turned in the whole country, mm-hmm. because the country follows what the king does.
Right.
And I thought it was really interesting. I'd never really seen this before. I mean, I'd read it, but where it talks about when Naaman went to the king and said, there's a prophet in Samaria that will heal me of my leprosy. And then the king said, I'm going to give you a letter, like a letter of introduction.
Mm-hmm.
And I never really saw that before, that he took the letter of introduction to the king of Israel because he assumed the king of Israel was going to be the prophet, because a prophet would be a spiritual leader. So this foreign king assumed that the spiritual leader, mm-hmm. of the whole, would the king of the whole country would be a spiritual leader. And so Naaman, if he had gone and given the truth of the Most High God, and this is just an idol, because of the admiration of the king for Naaman, it would have turned his heart.
Mm-hmm.
And I just thought it was interesting because he didn't give that letter to Elisha. He gave it to the king.
I know what you're trying to say is because the king of Syria. Okay, this is what Kathy was trying to say is that in the king of Syria, and this goes. Listen to this. Even goes in the church. Is anybody who's false gets honored. So when the king of Assyria, anybody who was, you know, they've got a temple called Ramon. They've got people that work in there, you know, astrologers, false people, whatever it is. They receive honor from the king. So when the king writes his letter, he's automatically assuming that the king of Israel honors their prophet just like they do their false prophets. But it doesn't work that way. Because if there's a true prophet, he's without honor. Tell me, were the false prophets under Israel, were they honored? Yes. Oh, yeah, they're honored. But the true ones aren't, because they tell the truth, because they preach the fellowship of his sufferings and being conformed to his death. All the false prophets, what were they preaching?
Peace.
Oh, the peace, we'll have victory. Yeah, with these horns you shall gore the Syrians until they're destroyed. Yeah. Amen. That's a word from the Lord, brother. So that's why, and the reason that, and this goes back to the partiality. See, he said to Elisha, I know there's no God in all the earth but your God. He goes back to the king, but because he's close to the king, because the king's above him and he's buddies with him, what's he do? Well, I'm going to bow down to Ramon. He should have said the same thing to the king of Syria that he said to Elisha. He should have gone back and said, I know there's no God in all the earth except the God of Israel. But he didn't do that. See, he showed partiality. So as a result, there was no revival. I mean, you can read, even today. I mean, you can read these through the Bible story after story, and every time you read one of those things, think of all the miraculous things that happened through the story of Israel. You know, Gideon defeating, you know, the Midianites. I mean, just one after another after another after, and every time it should have been a place for revival, and it wasn't. It's revival. We call it revival when it's the power of his resurrection. That's not when I call it revival. I call it revival when we experience the fellowship of his sufferings and we conform to his death. Now we have real revival. And the power of his resurrection. I'm not leaving that out. But we call it revival when we're experiencing the power of his resurrection. That seems to be a thing we do. Yeah. Go ahead. She's got something. Sharon?
I just kind of caught something when you were talking. I was thinking about how, you know, like what you said, you can't really have a resurrection if there's not a death. And so I was thinking about John the Baptist, that what, you know, the baptizing that always represents a type of death and stuff. That is what prepared the way for Jesus to come and do all the stuff that he did.
There you go.
It was the death prepared the way for the life that came.
That's good.
And then, oh my gosh, this is something that just kind of stuck out to me when you were reading. In Mark, where it was talking about how, where Jairus came to Jesus and how Jesus is going on, it says that there are crowds and crowds of people all around. Mm-hmm. And those people, every one of them needed something. They all needed something. And so Jairus comes. There was a death in that because he was a leader in the synagogue. So him to go out there, there was a death of that. So, I mean, so that opened it up for him. Then on the way, the lady with the issue of blood, there was a death to that because you weren't supposed to be out in public with something like that. So I just thought that was beautiful. And then something I've never seen before where, okay, so he's going and he's going through and stuff and he's on his way to Jairus' house and stuff like that. And there are crowds that says they're pressing him because there are sick people. There are people who need deliverance. There are people with lots of needs, right? And he says here in verse 37, but he did not let anyone follow him except for Peter, James, John, and the brother of James. And it struck me where I always had that thought of, okay, but all who came to Jesus were healed, right? But this just shows, I mean, he walked through a crowd where there was people who needed stuff. You know, but he heard what God said, the Father said, and okay, I'm sorry, I've got all these thoughts at one time. And like
that's good.
Well, yeah, but as you guys were talking about how, you know, that could have been a real revival and stuff like that, it could have been, even more amazing, I think, where Jesus, it wasn't just that he wanted to heal this person and that person and one person and one person there. It was like he's still looking for that real revival that you're talking about, where it's not just a person here and a person there and all that kind of stuff, but that we really get this and that there's a real death so that his life, that it prepares the way for his life on a huge scale, not just one here and one there.
Right. Absolutely.
I'm just...
Well, and just to carry your thought a little further, when you talked about Jairus' death, the Roman centurion, he died a death. The people that followed Jesus. See, that's what I've always tried to bring up. When they followed him out there into the, when they decided to follow him and leave the religious system, they was risking their lives. They were dying first before Jesus was healing them all. And see, we always try to just preach the power of the resurrection first, you know, without any consideration of the conforming to his death at all. And the power does come first. You know, it does come. Because Jesus, even though Jairus and all of those other people were dying because they had heard God speak of the resurrection of the power. See, the resurrection power doesn't always come in something physical. It can also come in you hearing it. You know, when God opens your eyes to who God really is, that's you just got something resurrected in you.
Yes.
When you learn that God is a healer and not a disease, you know, killer or maker or whatever, when you hear that, you just obtained some resurrection life right there. Something just got raised in you that was dead. Now you had some resurrection life, but now he's going to start dealing with you in the conforming of his death. So all those people that went to Jesus like that, they heard something first. They heard his resurrection life. Then they went and they got it. You see what I mean? And a lot of people, like you say, followed him, but they were following him because the crowds were following. They weren't hearing anything from God that this is the man. They were just excited about the miracles. No. No. Well, they will.
I know we've went around and around about this before, but I'm catching something, and God's been speaking to me about some other things. You know, just I've been really just listening to God about this, but he did not feel the obligation to lay hands on everybody, even though there was great need. And I know we talk like that, but just like, you know, you've mentioned before about, you know, at the Pool of Bethesda, what about all the other people that were laying there, you know, or sitting there waiting and stuff like that, that we really need to hear God. And I guess it's just proof that we don't just go out and lay hands on everybody unless God is telling us to do that, because Jesus didn't do that. Jesus waited, and he didn't just go out and do, okay, well, I've got the gift in me, so I'm just going to go do this. But he waited. He used self-control.
Yeah, let me read something to you. You got something, Kelly?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm going to be in James. You don't have to turn there, but I'm going to read in James.
Okay. She was talking about, like, even the person at the Pool of Bethesda. And do you ever think about there was several that didn't get healed? Did they get ticked later? You know, because, like, well, I was laying right by him, and I didn't get anything, and why did he get healed? But what I was thinking earlier was the things you're teaching again about the death and the resurrection, and you were talking about John the Baptist and things like that, and I was reminded of what God said several years ago. He said it's not enough to be a John the Baptist, a voice in the wilderness preparing the way of the Lord, but you have to become like Jesus and love the people enough to die for them. And that is part of, you know, we're, as Americans, we're wanting just the goody parts of God, and dying to ourselves is still a good part of God, because he's changing us, and in that change, of course, our lives will get better, our health will get better, our marriages will get better, we'll have more peace, prosperity, and joy. But we tend to want to jump to the resurrection part, the fun part, the exciting part, and we're not willing to allow God to change us and to allow that we're not allowing him to deal with our soul and our selfishness and bitterness, whatever is wrong with us. And you know, just like you were saying with this Naaman, if he had laid down and died to his reputation, died to his thinking, I still want to bow down to this other mm-hmm. God. You know, if he would died to that, see, he's thinking he would have lost everything, and he wouldn't have. He would have gained. And look at what he really lost, because he wouldn't lay down and die, so to speak. He lost out knowing I was the catalyst mm-hmm. for my nation.
My nation.
I was a catalyst to bring the glory of God in, and my king admires me, and I have his ear. And my king would have been the leader of the country. And when I showed my king that it's the one true God. See, what happens a lot of times, and what happened there, I'm sure, is because he didn't be honest with the king, and he compromised. You know, the king saw his healing, but because he looked at him and said, well, you're bowing to the same idol mm-hmm. that you did 2 weeks ago, then God must not be that big of a deal. And I've seen that in people that's come here through the past, other people I know in other cities and stuff, with their marriages or whatever, they start compromising the truth to try to keep peace and not make waves. And then the person looks at them and said, you know, their husband or wife or whatever said, well, if God was really that big to you, you wouldn't be always leaving church to go with me when I ask you to do something. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or you wouldn't say, well, I'm not going to be faithful, or I'm not going to tithe, or I'm not going to pray when I know God's telling me to pray because it irritates my husband or my wife. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I just see this everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And so then the witness that he would have had to the king was way watered down, because the king looked at him and said, well, he must not have been, I mean, yeah, he was a god, but he's no god any different than the idol we're worshiping.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty obvious, because nothing ever happened in Syria, and nothing happened in the whole rest of the history through 2 Kings. Nothing ever happened. So I want to read this scripture here, because I meant to read this too. I knew I had a long deal. Now, I want you to think, you've heard this scripture before, but I want you to think of it differently this time, okay? Because whenever we've heard it, I'm going to read in James about where you're being tempted. We always think of earthly temptations. But I want you to go back to when Jesus was tempted, and I want you to apply it to what we're going to read here, all right? Verse 12 in James chapter 1, verse 12. Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. Tell me, did Jesus persevere under trial when he was being tempted? And notice what he was being tempted with. He wasn't being tempted with, when we read this, we usually think pornography or R-rated or something, you know, lying, murder or something. He was being tempted with something that was good. Make stones into bread. You're hungry. Nothing wrong with making stones into bread. There's been a few times I wished I could have done that. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. So it's not, you need to understand this, folks. God is not causing you. You can't be normal and think this. God would never tell you to lay hands on somebody to heal them, but I'm not going to make it work just to see if you'll obey me. That is the most demonic concept I have ever heard. I hate that concept. God's not going to tell you to do something and smirch his name just to see if you're going to do it or not, or keep doing it. Or that, you see, that's tempting with evil, and God doesn't tempt with evil. Okay, I'm going to lay hands on you, tell you you're going to be healed, and then you're not going to be healed. So I can test Mike to see if he'll continue to lay hands on the sick. That is absolutely ridiculous. I hate that. But I've heard it. I've heard people preach it. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is, listen, here it is, each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Tell me, is it an evil desire to want to see people healed? No. Is it an evil desire to do it when God is saying not to do it? Now it became an evil desire. And look what it brings forth, folks. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fulfilled, when it's full grown, gives birth to death. So we've already discussed, had Jesus yielded to jumping off the pinnacle of the temple, what would have happened? And question, is it our desire to prove to the devil who God is? So do you think it was Jesus's? So had he yielded to proving by jumping off the pinnacle of the temple, it would have brought forth death. So now you know why I preach that because lawlessness abounds, the love of many grows cold. That's death. When your love for God grows cold, you died. The church has got to get this principle that I'm preaching to you. If they don't, we're not going anywhere. And I know we will, because God says we're going to have a bride perfect. So I know it's going to get it sometime. But wouldn't it be nice if they could get it now? I'm so thankful that many of you, or most of you, or maybe all of you, have gotten this principle. I'm certainly not against the power of his resurrection. Oh, boy. We love it. I mean, when I, a couple of weeks ago or whenever it was, Danielle was flagging with that blue flag, I was seeing the power of his resurrection. When Terry sings, when she plays the piano, when Bethel plays the piano, when I hear the prayers that go forth here, the music that's picked out, the songs that are, everything that goes on here, most of the time I'm hearing the power of his resurrection. But we also have to be conformed to his death and want to fellowship with his sufferings. Notice Paul said he wanted to fellowship with him. I want to be your buddy. It's hard to understand, but if you don't have one, you will never experience the true other. And I'm so thankful that many of you receive the fellowship of his suffering and you want to be conformed to his death. I like that. Makes it very easy to preach to people that want both of them. Amen? Anybody else have anything? James?
The way I take that story of Naaman is he didn't want to bow to that, but he had the king's ear, and he had to risk losing the king's ear.
Sure.
So, and the king could have rejected what he said as well. And that's what we're all faced with.
Yep.
That's where that suffering comes in, is because he had to fellowship with the suffering. He had to take part in the suffering, but he chose to continue. He chose to reject God and continue in what was normal for him, where there was no making any waves. Because the king could have rejected the God of Israel.
Right.
You know? Yeah, sure. And that's the risk.
That's the risk.
It's not that he didn't want to serve God. God just healed him. But he didn't want to take the risk of losing his reputation and losing his status with the king.
He could have been let out to a cliff and been thrown off, right?
Yeah.
See, that's the fellowship of his suffering, is that you choose to tell the truth when it might cost you getting thrown off the cliff. And see, he didn't want to do that. He loved the power of the resurrection, and we all do, but he didn't want the fellowship of his suffering. And until the church understands that, we're not going to go very far. Right. Well, yeah, he stayed alive. Like you said, he stayed alive, but was he really alive? You know, And we don't know because he's never mentioned again. Wouldn't it be nice if we found out what really, if they had a story in there, what happened to it? You know, Jesus was always, when the woman was caught in adultery, what did he say to her? He said, neither do I condemn you, power of his resurrection. Go your way and sin no more, conform to my death. That's the pattern. You see, that pattern is everywhere in Scripture. That's the pattern.
If you stop and think about it logically, even, he uses that terminology, resurrection. Without a death, there can be no resurrection.
Be no,
I mean,
resurrection.
Think about it physically.
Sure.
If you stayed alive, there's no resurrection.
No resurrection.
You have to die for there to be a resurrection. And that, I don't know where this is at, and I won't quote it right, but I just keep thinking about that scripture that says, unless a seed
falls
into the ground and dies, then what does it say after that?
It won't bring forth fruit.
Yeah.
It cannot bring forth fruit is what it says. And that's right. It's a principle that's over and over and over again. And many times we have to die knowing, because like we said, God has put that in us to care for the sick to see the need of people. You know that when, I can tell you right now, it's not in here, and you don't have to take this as truth, but I know when Jesus walked away from that pool of Bethesda, he's hearing, if you were the Son of God, you'd heal all of them. I can guarantee you that's what he heard. If you were the Son of God, you'd heal all those people laying there. But he didn't yield to it. And that's where the suffering comes in. You know, Jesus was for 30 years on this earth watching people in need and never did a thing. You know, it's almost hard for me to conceive of a people actually attaining to that, to where we never yield to the ifs, to where we're always obedient to God and never move other than that. It's got to be possible because he says he's going to have it. But, oh my gosh. Yes, got something now.
Thinking about that if of that, well, if it's God's will to heal, then why don't we? Why don't you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's another if.
Oh,
if
yeah.
It's God's will.
Look, I got a book at home, and I've shared it with here before, called The Charismatics. You ought to see how many times in there it says, if you believe this, how come you don't do this? You talk about, it's like you're reading Jesus' temptation through the whole book. That's what it says. Well, if you believed in this, how come you're not doing this? Well, if you believe in this, how come you're not doing this? That's what it constantly says. So we know who wrote the book. We know who inspired it. Because it's always if. And all throughout Jesus' ministry, all throughout the Bible, it's always if. And anyway, be careful of the ifs, okay? If's a nasty word. If is a two-letter word. Okay, anybody else? Okay, well, Father, we just, once again, we ask the Holy Spirit to continue to minister, continue to build upon this, reveal to us. And God, I just thank you that we are in a church that is allowing us to change, bringing change in our lives. And God, every time you expose these things to us, it's not because you want to condemn us, because it's not because you want to show us how bad we are. It's because just like throughout all of Scripture, you're trying to save people's lives. And Father, we thank you for that. Thank you that you're trying to save our lives, and that God, that we want to continue to yield not just to the power of his resurrection. God, we want that, but we want to yield to the fellowship of his suffering and being conformed to his death. Not that we've attained, but we're going to press on to the high mark, the high call of Christ Jesus, of being made in his image. And I just thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen and amen.